too late.
I want to thank everyone for coming out tonight, and I want to thank any online viewers that we end up getting off these trainings after we post them on our website. For the courtesy of our online viewers, if you are viewing this online right now, please make sure that you open up the Excel worksheet that also goes with these training modules, so you have that available when we begin to go over the Excel worksheet. For everyone in class, don't worry, I'm going to show you the Excel worksheet in here once we get to that point. The first thing that we're going to do is we're going to talk about some concepts in the school finance formula. So we're actually not going to go over any numbers immediately. So if you're a numbers person like me and you love numbers, you're going to have to calm that enthusiasm for just a while, because we're going to talk about concepts before we start diving into numbers. And the first, so we will bounce around a little bit as we discuss these concepts, but once we go over the numbers, it will help, because we'll be able to tie them all back in at that point. The first thing I have to ask is, how many parents do we have in the room? A lot of parents, that's good. I'm a parent as well. I have a 15, 12, and 3 and 2-year-old. So I got a nice family of 4. Now, how many of those parents are parents of multiple kids? So more than one, maybe even more than 2. That's good. Now, when you have, and the reason why I ask if you're a parent of a multiple kids instead of just one, is when you have an only child, the idea of fair is a little bit different when you have an only child. Because when you have an only child, what's fair to them is the fact that little Johnny down the road has a PSP and they don't. You know, and so you can always say, well, then go live with little Johnny's family. And that helps to deflate any of those arguments. However, when you have more than one child, and what they're complaining about is that you give more time, more energy, spend more money on one of their siblings instead of them, then that's a little tougher argument to deal with, because they're all your children and you always want to do your best to make sure you're treating all of them fairly. And so that's what we want to talk about first, is what does it mean exactly to treat all your children fairly? How do you define that? Come on in, pull up a seat. There is a sign-in sheet going on. So first, does that mean that you spend equally on them? For instance, with me, my 15, 12, 3, and 2-year-old, if I wanted to take them all clothes shopping, should I spend $100 on each of them for clothes? Now, I'll tell you, for my 3 and 2-year-old, $100 is way more than enough. I could get them an entire outfit that'll, you know, wardrobe that'll last them until they outgrow it. They probably wouldn't even wear everything before they started to outgrow it. But for my 15 and 12-year-old, my 15-year-old might come back with a pair of Nikes, and that's pretty much his old budget then if I'm spending $100 on them. So being fair isn't necessarily spending the same amount on all of them. Another example of that is if I took them all to eat, and let's say I take them out to McDonald's. Well, if I want to spend $3 on my little ones to get them a Happy Meal, which is more than enough food for them, when I turn around and try to give a Happy Meal to my 15-year-old, he's going to laugh at me and ask me why I've given him a snack for dinner. So it's not necessarily spending the same amount of money on them. Does it mean buying them identical products? My 15, 3, and 2-year-old are all boys, luckily. And I have one princess, my daughter, who's 12. And if I was to go home and tell my 15-year-old that I've got him and his little brother's feminine products because I happened to have to buy those for their sister and I wanted to make sure they were all being treated fairly, I don't think he would appreciate that too much. I think he'd probably have some choice words on how I just wasted money trying to buy them identical products in order to demonstrate how I want to be fair to each of them. It's a men spending equal time with each child. My 2 and 3-year-old luckily sleep through the majority of nights now, but it hasn't been that way always, not even in recent times. But in the event that they do wake up in the middle of the night and it takes me 15 minutes to console them and get them back to sleep, does that then mean that I should turn around and wake up my 15 and 12-year-old and say, well, hey, you know, I just had to spend some time with your little brothers getting them to go back to sleep. I want to make sure I'm being fair to you guys and I'm giving you equal time, so I'm waking you up. You're going to stay up with me for about 15 to 20 minutes, and then after that I'll let you go back to sleep just so I balance the table with you guys. I don't think they would view that as being fair either. Does it mean that they need to participate in identical activities? I've coached my son's team, my oldest son's my 15-year-old. I've coached his sports teams ever since he was about 5 years old. Started him with T-ball, then moved him straight into football. He fell in love with football, which was great because that's my favorite sport, and so I stayed with that with him. All the way until recent times, I wouldn't be surprised if in a couple months I'm out there coaching him again, as long as I can find some time. My daughter, on the other hand, she started with cheerleading. She didn't like it too much, but she did start with cheerleading. And I can imagine if I went to each of them and I said, well, you know, your sister's in cheerleading, so it's only fair that I put you in cheerleading too, and since your brother's in football, it'd be only fair if I put you in football as well. I don't think either one of them would look at that as being fair. I don't think they would feel that they need to be in the exact same activities. So the question is, how does that play into the equalization formula, which is what we're going to get to here in a minute. But first, we're going to talk about what is exactly equalization. And this is my definition, so you're not going to, you know, find it in Webster or in Carter or any other place where you try to find a definition. But to me, equalization is the process of providing equal funding for students based on that student's individual needs. So based on what the needs of that particular student is, you try to provide funding for that student. And so some examples, let's think about some examples of what are the different types of needs that students can have in a school district that would require them to be funded at different levels. So that's actually not a rhetorical question. I'd like some hands raised. What do you feel are some reasons why there are some students that need to be funded at a different level than other students? Yes, Tisha.
Special
education. Yes, special education is one of the main reasons why students are funded at different levels. Special education is divided up into different groups, and there'll be different funding levels for each student based on their special education needs. Can anyone give me another example of why we would fund at different levels for students?
For gifted students, make sure they remain interested.
Yes, gifted students. Gifted, in a way, we also treat as special education, a different type of special education, a different type of need. But yes, that'd be another example for why you would have to look at different funding levels. Tisha?
Grade level.
Grade level is a good one. Again, as I said, with my 15 and my 3-year-old, obviously they're not going to consume food at the same rate. Additionally, when you look at textbooks, a textbook that teaches ABCs and 1, 2, 3s is considerably less expensive than one that's going to teach algebra and trigonometry. So we'll talk about how grade level and we'll even specifically get to how textbooks are even treated differently based on grade level. Give you an example of another reason. One thing that's mandatory for anybody who has more than 2 children, it should come in a parent handbook automatically, is a Costco card. So any of you who have multiple kids, I'm pretty sure you have one of these in your wallet. In fact, you'll notice that Costco is one of the few places that actually market themselves towards the bigger families, and it's pretty obvious because when you get there, what do they have that nobody else has? The shopping cart with 2 seats in the front. Anywhere else you go, you only get 1 seat in the front. The 2 seats in the front actually is a great help for me because, again, 3- and 2-year-old, I can plop them both down, I'm good, so I'm glad Costco has that. So when you have more than 2 children, when you have multiple children, and you're going to these bulk warehouse stores like Costco, it's expected then that you're paying less per child to do things like eat dinner, eat breakfast, and even to do some other events because of the fact that now you're buying for bulk, you're buying multiple. It works similar for districts. Districts that are larger have more flexibility. They can do things like control class size and have the flexibility in class size and change their staffing patterns in order to accommodate and make a savings. Whereas a small district who maybe only has 10 first graders, they don't have a lot of choice in how many teachers they're going to have to teach the 10 first graders. You have to have one. Whereas if you have 100 first graders, well, maybe that's 3, maybe that's 4. That's your decision. Someone in a small district doesn't have that same decision. So these are the different ones that we've talked about. Size of the district, grade level, special education. There's another one on there, it doesn't particularly pertain to Kyrene, but it's isolation status. So that is districts who are way out in the boondocks and your school is 30 miles from the nearest district school and you're out there in the middle of nowhere, you also get different weights because it is then expected that when you're out there in the middle of nowhere and Walmart's not just around the corner, that you do have some higher expenses there as well. The next thing I want to talk about is the Teacher Experience Index. And again, we're going to get to the numbers on it later, but I just first want to talk about what it is and why we have it. Now, in the private sector, when you're looking at doing a budget savings, one possible opportunity is you can consider doing retirement incentives. Do some retirement incentives, cut off a lot of your top-heavy employees, bring in some fresh out of college employees, and you can make a savings there. Maybe they don't do the work as good, but they might do it good enough and offer you a chance to get some savings. At a district, you wouldn't expect that to not also be an option. So, you know, it could be an option at a district as well. However, from the state view, you have to consider that. What would be the ramifications of allowing districts to do something like that, of constantly wanting to look at releasing experienced teachers and bringing in new teachers for the budget savings? Well, you'd have a lot of inexperienced teachers across the state then. You would also have a lot less desire to pursue that profession since people would know that, you know, you don't have a long lifespan in that profession. So there could be a lot of disadvantages to districts doing measures such as that. And so what was introduced was the Teacher Experience Index, where a district actually receives funding based on how top-heavy they are with their teachers. And so that discourages anyone from wanting to then lay off your high-level teachers and bring in fresh teachers because it will result in a loss of funding, which is what we're going to discuss once we get into the numbers. I'll show you how there's a loss of funding if you were to take all of your experienced teachers and replace them with first-year teachers. Next thing we want to talk about is transportation. I'll tell you, a lot of times, especially out here in Kyrene, what I hear is, well, we could have a real quick solution. We could just get rid of open enrollment, and that would solve everything. We wouldn't have to be spending all this money to be busing these kids around the mountain or busing these kids down from Maricopa. I've heard that comment several times. But the fact of the matter is, we get paid for our transportation. We get paid from the state. And the amount of our payment is based on the approved daily route miles. So how many miles we're traveling each day actually impacts how much funding we get from the state to cover transportation. Additionally, all those students bring in a lot more revenue because of the fact that we get paid per student, and we have about 3,700 open enrollment students right now, so that's a significant amount of funding that's equivalent to about six schools that we'd have to look at closing if we didn't have them. So we're going to talk about how we're funded for transportation and about how that's based on approved daily route miles, the miles traveled per student. So 1 mile is pretty much the key to look at. If the average student is coming out to traveling more than a mile, you get more funding than if they're going less than a mile. So when a bus holds 84 students, you kind of need the longer routes to make sure that you're up over that 1 mile average. You also get funding for field trips and extended year handicap. And again, when we get into the numbers, we'll talk specifically about how that's calculated. Equalization base. This is basically the results of the per pupil formula. It's the amount that it yields. We'll go into the specifics again about how to calculate it, but when you talk about equalization base, it is the per pupil formula has said that the district has X number of dollars available to spend, and that is the equalization base. And what we'll also discuss later is where that money comes from. Because a portion of it will come from local property taxes, and a portion of it will come from state aid. And in other districts, in more affluent districts, in a district such as Cave Creek, you'll see that they get all the money from state aid. In a district such as Roosevelt, you'll see, or for Cave Creek, excuse me, that they get all their money from local taxes. In a district such as Roosevelt, they'll get the vast majority of their funding from state aid and very little from local taxes. So it's really based on the situation of the district, and that's, we'll discuss how that gets divided up. But equalization base, the thing to remember about equalization base is that's the total. That's the result of the per pupil formula. Equalization assistance. Equalization assistance is how much you're getting from the state. So the base is how much you get total. Equalization assistance says this much is going to come from the state. So the rest of it, when you check your tax bill and you see that little line that says Kyrene School District, that's where the rest of it comes from. It comes from your local property taxes. Average daily membership. This is a key term. Average daily membership is how many students we're getting paid for. So when you think about that, think about if you wanted to pay every district for how many students they have, well, what's the first thing you need to know? How many students do they have? And how would you decide that? Do you want to show up to the school on the first day of school and count their students? Say, okay, we had this many on the first day of school. And then say, okay, well, that's how much money you're gonna get because based on your first day of school, that's how many kids showed up to the seats. What happens when little Johnny comes to Kyrene on the first day of school and says, you know what, I really don't like it here. Mom, can I go down the street to one of the other districts? And they do that. And let's say that district starts the first day of school next week, the week after us. And you go over there to count their students, and there's little Johnny again, and now you paid for little Johnny twice. Maybe the week after that, he goes to a charter school. Now you paid for little Johnny three times. So you couldn't necessarily just go based on the first day of school and pay everybody that way, especially when everybody's on different calendars and starting the first day of school at different times. So the first concept that they came up with was, well, let's look at the first 100 days of school. And we're going to see the first 100 days of school. If somebody's there for all 100 days, then that counts for a full student with full funding. What they found out was that in some cases, someone may spend the first 80 days at one school, and it's the first 80 days of their calendar, but could still manage to be in the first 80 days of another school's calendar who started later. And so you're still paying for little Johnny more than once, and that was something that didn't sit well downtown. They said, look, we only want to provide one education for little Johnny. How do we get this down to providing just one education for little Johnny? And what they decided was, if little Johnny wants to go full time to two different schools, which is a lot easier to do nowadays with all the online instruction that's being offered, little Johnny decides to go to school full time, two different schools, they're going to split funding. And so that's what happens to districts now. We can provide all 180 days of school for little Johnny, and he is in there just like the person sitting next to him. Never misses a day. We have the teacher available for him. So our cost is the same for little Johnny as the student next to him. But little Johnny decides he wants to go home, do some early prep classes to get ready for Tempe Union. He's going to take some online high school classes. And because of the fact that little Johnny is now participating in more than one school and more than one school district, our funding is going to be prorated based on his participation in other schools. Now, when they started doing this, we have a program at the state level called SACE that helps do all these nice magical calculations. Whatever the legislature can think of, it goes into SACE, and SACE spits out the numbers. People haven't been happy with the numbers that have been spit out of SACE for the last few years now. Now, when you do get them, and how long you have to wait to get them. So what they decided was, a good friend of mine, Jim, was working with a group, and they had a great idea. They said, well, 100 days sounds complicated. It's too many days. We don't need 100 days to look at. What if we only looked at 4 days? If we just picked out 4 days, we could do a school district's 40th day, their 80th day, their 120th day, whatever 4 days we want to take, we could take 4 days, and then based on those 4 days, do all these calculations that we want to do. And that would simplify the calculation, because then you're not looking at 100, you're dealing with four. It has to make it a lot easier and make the data a lot more reliable. So I was actually fortunate enough to be working down at the Department of Ed when Jim had came in with that idea, and I told him I think that's a great idea. But charters have a lot more flexibility than school districts. And so if you're looking at 4 days and you're looking at it based on the school's calendar, it kind of leaves the door open for charters to do some funny business with that, because they can control their calendars, they can open up a lot of multiple tracks, and there's different things that the charters have the ability to do that school districts don't have the ability to do. And so I told him I want to see one slight modification of that. Let's not say days based on the school's calendar. Let's pick 4 days. September 15th, November 15th, January 15th, March 15th. Starting next year, schools will be paid based on how many students are enrolled on those 4 days. For this year is the last year of the 100-day formula, but going next year, it's going to be based on those 4 days. This actually passed a while ago, but the state's been having trouble implementing the changes, so that's why it's been delayed and pushed back all the way till next year. But that'll make it a lot simpler for coming up with what is your average daily membership when you're looking at four specific days of the year. Yes?
Are you talking about actual enrollment on those days, not the children actually being in the classroom seat that day?
Yes, so the question is if we're referring to enrollment and not attendance, and we are. We're referring to that the student is enrolled. Yeah, there it goes on the second bullet. But yes, it's based on the student being enrolled with the district, so no, we're not gonna have a pizza party at every school on September 15th to make sure everybody shows up. So, you know, don't tell your child to go mark that on their calendar for next year. You'd say, hey, I know something's gonna happen at your school next year. No, there'll be no pizza parties. It's based on enrollment. So as long as the child is enrolled with the district, we'll get credit for them. They don't necessarily have to be in attendance. Now there is a rule that if a child doesn't show for 10 consecutive days, that we have to disenroll the child and disenroll them back to the last date of attendance. So there is a little trickiness on how that's going to play into this formula. But yes, it's based on enrollment, not attendance. They don't have to physically be present at the school on those days. Are there any other questions on average daily membership? Again, this is a very important topic, so I want to make sure that we have average daily membership down, because when we go forward, you'll see that that's what all the calculations are based on, is what our average daily membership is. No one else? All right, you ready for the fun? The fun part is that now we're going to go over the numbers. So what I'm going to be handing out to you next is called our APOR 55-1. This maybe you can just take one and pass it back that way. Anything that's extra, just leave it in the back. Oh, did you get someone that way already? You got enough? Okay. If anybody doesn't get one, please raise your hand so I can get one out to you. The APOR 55-1, yes?
Read it back there.
Any more? Does everyone have one? Okay. The APOR 55-1 is a payment report, or actually the calculation of our equalization base that's provided by the Department of Education. So all those concepts that we talked about and all the numbers that we're about to talk about, this is all presented by the Department of Education. They take our data that we submit to them and they calculate out what the district is entitled to based on their enrollment. And that's what's reflected on this report. And that is our goal for today. Our goal for today is that when you leave here tonight, you understand all the numbers that are presented on this report. Now, one thing you will notice about the report is that there are four pages. But if you look at the top, you will see that it says on the last page, page 6 of 6. Pages 2 and 3 are intentionally removed. And the reason being that pages 2 and 3 only apply to districts who have online instruction, and to date, Kyrene doesn't currently offer any online instruction. That doesn't say that we won't do it in the future, it just means that currently we don't offer any online instruction. So let's talk about what's on that first page and what's in some of those subsequent pages, what we're gonna go over tonight. We're gonna go over total weighted student count. I'm gonna go over the base support level, TSL and TRCL, which stands for Transportation Support Level and Transportation Revenue Control Limit. That's the method for how we get funded for transportation. We're going to talk about the Revenue Control Limit, which is basically totaling all this stuff up here above. We're going to talk about our capital outlay revenue limit, that's CORAL, and we're going to talk about our soft capital allocation, that's the SEA that you see there. And then we'll finish with talking about equalization assistance, the money that we're going to get from the state. So the first thing we're going to talk about on total weighted student count is when you look at that report, you'll see that it's divided up into a couple of different sections. The top section shows our average daily membership, and school districts are paid based on their prior year's average daily membership, which is why you'll see our prior year's average daily membership reflected on top. In the middle, what you'll see is what's called the Group A weight. It's the weight given to all students based on their grade level. And then when you get down to the bottom, you'll see special education, the Group B weights. Not all of the Group B weights are special education. There is a Group B weight, for example, for K-3, so K-3 is not typically thought of as a Group B weight. At one point in time, there was a Group B weight for kindergarten specifically, a weight of 1.352 that originally started off at, I believe, at 0.856. When that weight went away, that is what everyone is referring to when they said the state is no longer funding full-day kindergarten. It was because they removed that Group B weight for kindergarten. So we're going to talk a little more detail about what these weights are and how you apply them to our student counts. And to do that, we're going to go into our Excel file. So while I'm pulling it up, anyone watching at home, this is your time to hit a quick Alt-Tab and switch over to your Excel file as well. There we go. On this first spreadsheet here, what we have is the same numbers that are reflected on that page one of the report I just handed out. It's the calculation for the total weighted student count. So on top, what you can see is the Group A weights. You can see that we have 93.625 credit for preschoolers with disabilities. The school district does not get funded for all preschoolers. We get funded for preschoolers who have disabilities that we take into the district. That's why some preschool is tuition-based. We don't get funding from the state and local property taxes for tuition-based preschool that's offered to all preschoolers. We get funded on the preschool disability. And additionally, preschool and kindergarten have their ADM cut in half. So a student who's here for all 180 days in kindergarten or preschool, that's a value of 0.5. It's not a value of 1 to begin the calculation. All other grades are at a full 1, and then you begin the calculations. But preschool and kindergarten are cut in half. So 93.625. I bet you're expecting and hoping for a nice, even round number, like there's 92 preschoolers. Doesn't work out that way because, again, we're doing an average based over the 100 days. So if little Johnny was with us for 75 of the first 100 days, he's good for 0.75. And then if little Johnny's in preschool or kindergarten and you cut that in half, he's now good for 0.375. So that's why you'll see the odd numbers on all the ADM numbers. The next number is the actual weight that's applied. And you'll see for preschool that it's 1.45. That weight is consistent across the state. That's the state weight for preschool. When we multiply this 93.625 by 1.45, we get 135.756. Now again, a point I intended to make earlier, which I'm going to get to now since I forgot. The reason why we have weights. At a state level, you have to determine how much funding is needed for all students. So how much funding do you need for a student with autism? How much funding do you need for a ninth grader versus how much funding you need for a second grader? And you have to set those funding levels each year. So you can imagine at a state level, with all of these different categories that you see on that report, if you had to set a funding level for every single one of those categories, that would take an awful lot of work especially since every number you decide on is heavily debated. And every year you would have somebody protesting that the number that you set for their child's special education category should be higher than what you set it in the previous year. And you'd have to make those points every single year. So they didn't want to have to fight those battles every year. They came up with the weighting. The first year that they set all the weights, it was, okay, this is the dollar amount that we want to spend per child. That's a base amount called the base level. Little Johnny has autism. We recognize that it costs more to educate little Johnny than it would for any child who doesn't have any special education needs. What we need to determine is how much more does it cost for little Johnny's education than these other children. And that determination is what you see in the weight. So when you see a weight for autism, it says 6.024, and that's that A-R right there. It means autism resource. And you will get all these definitions later, too. When you see that 6.024, it means that they recognize that the cost of educating an autistic child was 6.024 times more expensive than the cost of educating a child without needs. And how that comes into play is that now, each year, there's one number that they have to redefine. They redefine that base level. How much do you want to spend per student? By redefining the base level, you've now redefined the value for all of these categories because they're in proportion based on their weights. You say it costs $3,000 for a student with no needs? Well, little Johnny's autistic. He gets six times that value. His education costs $18,000. The next year you say it costs $4,000 for a student with no needs, little Johnny jumps up to $24,000. So everyone else has their funding level changed in proportion to what their weight gives them in accordance to the base level. So back to where we were, since I forgot to make that point earlier and I'm coming back to it. Preschool. So for preschool students, it was determined that 1.45 was an adequate weight for preschool students. Now I know that looks high compared to all the other grade levels, but you have to remember that preschool is cut in half, so it's really not that high. It's not that preschool is the most expensive grade level, because when you cut them in half and then you apply the 1.45, it doesn't even take them over the one. So you see that for the preschool students, 93.625 multiplied by that weight gives you the 135.756 for the weighted count. Next weight we're going to talk about is K-8. So they had to determine how much of a weight to give for students who are in grades K through 8. And they decided that that was going to be based on whether the district's isolated and the size of the district. Basically, if a district has less than 600 students, and that's a district or a charter, but if a district has less than 600 students, they get a higher weight. Again, because of the Costco example I tried to give earlier. When you have more students, you have more flexibility, there's more cost savings measures that you can take, whereas when you only have the 10 first graders, there's not too much you can do. You have to provide one teacher for those 10 first graders. And so they decided that if you are lower than 600, you're going to get a higher weight. And that weight varies based on where your student count falls between that 0 and 600. The highest weight given to any district for K-8 is 1.559, so that's off on the right for you guys to be able to see, and you guys at the completion of Module 2 will have this spreadsheet. So 1.559 is the highest weight that anyone can get for their K-8 students. 912, the weights go higher. Bigger students, more expensive. Weights go higher, and the highest weight for a 912 district would then be 1.669. So we multiply these out, and you'll see for our kindergarten, our 16,668 ADM gives us a weighted count of the 19,302 once we apply that weight. Anyone who's attended a board meeting, the first question that they'll always ask is, well, I thought our enrollment was 18,000. And it is. Our enrollment is 18,000. However, ADM is not the same as enrollment. Of those 18,000, some of those are kindergartners who only get half credit. Some of those are tuition-based preschool who don't even come into this formula. And some of those are the preschool disabilities who, again, only get half credit. So we do have over 18,000 enrolled, but our ADM for the district, as you can see, is 93.625 for preschool disability and 16,668 for grades K through 8. So our group A, total weight count for group A, when we multiplied the weights based on grade level, gave us $19,437, or 437 ADM. So the next weights are group B weights. They work in a similar fashion. You get the count for everyone who falls into each one of those group B categories, multiply it by the weight, get a weighted count, and then at the end what we have here is our total weighted count for group B. These two counts are then totaled together, and that gives us our total weighted student count. So that's the basis for our per pupil formula that we're going to continue with. And the total, when we add that 1,900 and the 19,000 above, gets us to this highlighted number of 21,371.707. So that's how much it's going to get multiplied by the base level.
So everyone in group B is also in group A?
Yes. All students go in group B, in group A, and students with needs go in group B. So anyone in group B, yes, they're being funded on under both counts.
So I'm line 15, for example. I don't remember which category that was. What's player 6? So I'm sorry, row down there. That's really 7 times more expensive than one.
Yes. Because little Johnny is not only getting this 6 times right here on this weight, but he also gets credit for one up here as well. I'm going to flip back to the PowerPoint real quick. Okay, so the next value we're going to talk about is the base support level, which is what this total weighted student count is going to be used to help determine is our base support level. So, the base level, as I said, is established to say this is how much every student should be funded at across the state. That base level, however, can be increased under certain circumstances. One of those is called the Teachers' Compensation Program. That program is pretty universal. There's not a lot of hoops that you have to jump through to get it. Basically, if I remember right, there's about 95% of districts who already have teachers' compensation program, and that increases your base level by 1.25%. So I'll show you the math on that when we go back to the Excel spreadsheet. Another one of those reasons why your base level can be increased is if you have career ladder or optional performance incentive program. Career ladder is only available to 28 districts in the state. Kyrene is one of the 28. Optional Performance Incentive Program, which is basically the same thing as Career Ladder, is only available in 2 districts. No new districts have been able to join either one of those programs in quite some time. So if you're a district like Gilbert down the street and you wanted to be a part of Career Ladder, you were told, no, you can't join this program because the state didn't want to have to dedicate any more funding towards those programs. And because of that, they didn't allow any more districts in. And because they had now created something that they were unwilling to allow any other district to participate in, it was ruled unconstitutional, and now Career Ladder is in the process of being phased out. So when we go to our Excel spreadsheet, I'm going to show you how that plays into our base level. The base support level is then to take that total weighted student count, which we just discussed. Add the group A and the group B together, you get your total weighted student count. Take that number, multiply it by this base level, which we're about to go over in more detail. Then multiply that by the teacher experience index, which we are also going to go over in more detail. And then add in any adjustments. Now in Kyrene, the only adjustment we ever see that gets added into our base support level is for audit expenses. We do get a reimbursement for audit expenses. And so there's about a $34,000 credit that gets added on to the top of our base support level. You won't see that in the reports that I handed out because that is the September APOR 55-1. However, when I give you all the links to show you how you can find all this information for any district and any charter in the state, what you'll notice is that when you go to our page, the October report does reflect our adjustment for audit expenses. So now let's get back to the Excel file so we can talk over some more numbers. So the statutory base level, right off here on the side, for this year is $3,267.72. When you increase that for teachers' compensation program, which again I said is basically in every district in the state, there's a few of them that don't have it, but that'll kick you up to $3,308.57. For Career Ladder, at Career Ladder's peak, it was 5.5% add-on for every district that was Career Ladder. So your base level was increased by another 5.5%. When they took it out the first year, they reduced Career Ladder down to 5%. They left OPIP alone. Then in subsequent years, they decided that OPIP was going to join the party, and OPIP got decreased with them as part of this phase-out plan. And it went from 5% down to 4%, which is where we're at now. Next year, it'll be at 3%, then 2%, then 1%, and then you'll never hear the term Career Ladder again. Might come back as something else, but in a different way, but you'll never hear it called Career Ladder again. So that additional 4% puts our base level up to $3,440.91. Now, anyone that sat through board meetings or anyone that's heard me speak before, and when I talk about kids and the value of kids, because everybody wants to know what number do you assign to the value of kids and how much funding is generated by bringing a student into the district, you'll know that usually I'll say about $5,000. You can see that $3,440 is significantly shy of $5,000, which is why I bring you back to this weighting concept. Every student has a weight. And since every student has a weight, in order to find out how much you're getting off of each student, you would also have to apply these different weights. This funding is just for what goes into the revenue control limit. When we get into the capital outlay revenue limit and the soft capital allocation, you'll see that the ADM also plays into those numbers, so you'd have to add that in as well. And when you add everything up, it comes to just shy of $5,000 for a student who has no needs. We get about just under $5,000. At one point, it was a lot higher. So there's our base level, $3,440.91. You'll see over here, and you'll also see on page 2 of the APOR 55-1, if you go up to the top, it takes that total weighted student count, multiplies it by that base level amount of the $3,440.91. It then takes that number and multiplies it by the teacher experience index, which we're going to talk about in more detail now. What's being handed out to you now is our teacher experience index report that is also created by the Department of Education. When I was down at the Department of Education, I had the ability to go in and see the teacher experience calculations for all districts in the state. And one thing I noticed is there was teachers in there, and I believe the highest one I saw was a teacher who had 79 years of experience. I can only imagine how old that teacher must be to have 79 years of experience. I was almost curious enough to want to go down there and meet her and figure out how in the world did you continue teaching for 79 years? But 79 years of experience. This calculation wants to come up with the average experience of teachers in a district. Now, as I mentioned, there's a lot of small districts out there. So let's say you're a small district and you've got three teachers. They each got 5 years of experience. So your average experience is 5 years. Now let's say this teacher who has the 79 years of experience comes down and applies with your district. And you realize she has 79 years of experience. Can you imagine how much that would increase the average for that district if you had someone in there who now has 79 years of experience? You would overnight more than quadruple your average experience for your district because of hiring this one teacher. And if you're going to create a formula to fund people based on the average experience of their teachers, then that's probably something you want to avoid. So if you have 79 years of experience, 52 years of experience, 27, if you have any number more than 15 for the purposes of this calculation, you only get credit for 15 years of experience. 15 is the maximum anyone's allowed in the calculation. The other thing is that you created this formula, this teacher experience index, as a method for paying districts and encouraging them and incentivizing them to retain these experienced teachers, to pay these teachers for that experience as well. And so the other thing you had to look at was, is the district paying that teacher for that years of experience? I'll tell you that if someone comes in to Arizona from a state like Michigan or somewhere else, and they're a teacher and they've been teaching out in Michigan for 3 years, but they've never taught in Arizona, there's a good chance that they might only get credit for 1 year experience when they get that initial, when they get their initial salary. And they'll go on our pay scale as 1 year of experience, and that's how they'll be funded. And each subsequent year, then they'll move. We now have a stepless schedule, but back when you stepped, that could happen to you. You get on there at one, and then you step with everyone else after that. So the thing that they wanted to look at with this formula was, well, how much credit did the district give them for their experience when they first got there? And so if you took somebody from Michigan, they had 4 years of experience, but they got to your district and you gave them credit for one, then that first year when that teacher was counted into this formula, they also got counted as one. Now the assumption is that they continue to move on after that. So the next year they'll be counted as two, and everybody gets incremented 1 year automatically at the end of each year, as long as they stay with the district. So basically that years of experience that's reflected on this report isn't a true years of experience. What it is how much credit they got when they first got into the district, added into how many years of district experience that they have. And that comes up with the numbers. Yes, Jody.
Is there any place in that formula where you factor in advanced degrees or additional training for the teachers?
No. How much credit we get in the teacher experience index doesn't take into account whether or not they have a doctorate, a master's, bachelor's. They can only have, well, they can't have a high school diploma, they have to be certified. But regardless of whatever their degree is, it doesn't factor into the calculation. It's only looking at the experience. So what you see in there on that teacher's experience index, and I'll pull that up here on the board as well, meant to have this website open before we started. I knew I was forgetting something else.
No thanks.
Hold on just a sec. This is the school finance page down at the Department of Education. SDER stands for School District Employee Reports. And don't worry, you don't have to write all this down. At the completion of Module 2, I will give you complete instructions on how to get here. So here is the report that you have in front of you right now. So you'll see that we have FTE stands for full-time equivalent. So a teacher that's working half-time, you only get, that's only half an FTE. So for the purposes of this calculation, that's only counted as half. You'll see in some cases, it's not even as simple as half or full. Sometimes they may work, you know, 2 hours a day, 6 hours a day, 3 hours a day, and you have to play out that FTE. And that's why you'll have some of these odd numbers in the total FTE. But what you do to get the average is you take each year of experience, multiply it by how many FTE fit for that year of experience, and that gives you the number off to the side. So 1 times 29.5 gives you the 29.5. Then you take the 2 times the 18 teachers who have 2 years of experience, and that's 36. That's 36 years of experience. Do that all the way down, total up your total years of experience, divided by your total FTE. And what you come out with is off here to the right, that in Kyrene, the average teacher has 10.3 years of experience, which is very experienced teachers. In the state of Arizona, the average is 9.1259. So as you can see, we are above the state average. Since we are above the state average, we are entitled to additional funding. If we were below the state average, we don't get penalized. So there are, since this is an average, there are of course districts that are below the average. There's no penalty to them for being below the average. There's just no additional funding unless you're above the average. So the first thing you do is you figure out how much you're above the average. So the 10.3 minus the 9.12, and you'll see that Kyrene is above the state average by 1.17. The next part is to multiply that by 0.0225. Can't tell you the complete details on where the 0.0225 comes from. From what I was told back when I first started asking that question, which was my very first question, by the way, when I looked at this report. I looked at it, I saw it, everything made sense. Then they told me the 0.0225 part, and I was like, why? Why 0.0225? Where did somebody just, were you guys drawing numbers out of a hat and that one came to the top? From what I was told, they had a mathematician look at this and help them with this formula, and the mathematician suggested that number, and supposedly the number stuck since then. It's not been changed since this formula was created. So 0.0225 was what it gets multiplied by. Then that amount is what's added on top of 1 to give you your index. And our index is 1.0265, which is a very good index. There aren't that many districts that would have a higher teacher experience index than Kyrene. I'll go back to our Excel spreadsheet and show you how that impacts our funding. So that 73.5 million is now multiplied by that index, that 1.0265. to give us 75.4 million. So basically, because Kyrene continues to have more experienced teachers than the state average, we receive an additional $2 million in funding. So that's what that index means for us. Now that has a significance when you're talking about possible ways to save the budget. Because if you were to tell me that we could make a savings on the budget by offering a retirement incentive to our very experienced teachers, and that you think we can get maybe 50 of them to bite on that incentive and get out and then replace them with first year teachers, and that the change in salary would then offer a significant savings to the district, the first numbers I'm going to come analyze is this TEI, and that'll be available in the spreadsheet for you to play with as well. So what you'd want to do is, well, let's see what the impact of that would be. Let's drop our 15 plus years teachers down by 50. And then let's increase our first year teachers by 50. So if we did a retirement package like that last year and we managed to push 50 experienced teachers out the door and replace them with 50 new teachers, you'll see that that would have dropped our funding for TEI down to about $800,000. That'd be 1.2 million, about 1.1, 1.2 million that we would have lost for making a decision like that? Would it have been a loss in funding? Yes, Tisha. No, this is for actual teachers. It's not looking at substitutes. So you'll see the significant change there. So if we were to consider something like that, that's one of the things that we have to always analyze as well. It's not just analyzing how much does this save in cost, because in a lot of cases, we also have to analyze, will this impact funding? And if so, how much will it impact funding? So, for instance, doing a retirement incentive, if you told me it was going to save $2 million in cost, but you wanted to put together a package to give $1 million of that to the employees because that's what the incentive is, then I'd have to come back to you and say, well, you're going to give the employees $1 million. We're going to lose $1.2 million in funding, and you're going to save $2 million on salaries. So the net effect then is that we're going to lose $200,000 from trying to go forward with this idea. And then at that point, I have to recommend, well, that's not an idea worth going forward with. So that's why it's always important to know our funding structure, because that's what plays into a lot of the decisions that have to be made as far as what we should and shouldn't do with our budget and some of the other decisions that we have to make. So before we move forward, does anyone have any other questions about how the teacher experience index is calculated? All right. So the next step, after multiplying that 73.5 by the index and getting that 75.4, is to add in any base support level adjustments. And as I said, the only base support level adjustment that we would have is for audit expenses. We do get reimbursed for what we have to pay to our auditing firm. Our base support level gets adjusted based on what we have to pay to our auditing firm. And that adjustment would be in there. It's not in there right now because it's not on the report that I handed to you, but if you were to go online today and look at an updated report, you would see $34,000 added in there. But that gives you our base support level. So again, you'll see that on page 2, the calculation of the base support level. Moving on from that, we're now going to talk about transportation. Transportation, always a fun topic. Two numbers, and I'm going to explain why we have two numbers. Transportation support level, which is based on your approved daily route miles and eligible students, and transportation revenue control limit, which is based on your transportation support level and how much it's changed from 1 year to the next. So why the redundancy? Let's say if I was going to put a formula together to pay every district for their transportation, and I wanted that formula to be data-driven. I wanted to link it to their expenses. So I'd come up with this formula and I'd say, well, this is how I'm going to figure out how much it costs you to transport your students. And based on that, that's how much funding I'm going to give you to make sure we're adequately providing enough funds for you to transport those students. Because what you don't want to happen is you don't want districts to say, well, as a cost savings measure, next year we are not transporting any students. You wouldn't want a district to do that. Because what happens to little Johnny if his mom and dad can't give him a ride to school? How does he get his education? You want districts to provide transportation. You want to set some rules around it, but you want to make sure they're providing transportation, and you make sure they're going to do it by providing them funding to do it. So that's why you come up with a transportation support level. But why the second number? Well, let's say I'm looking at this transportation support level, and I'm thinking to myself, you know what? It would be nice if we didn't just pay them based on how much they spend. Because if I'm going to get money based on how much money I'm spending, how concerned am I about how efficient I am with that money? If you tell me for every dollar I spend, you're going to reimburse me a dollar, do you think I'm going to go for the low-end stuff or am I going to go for the high-end stuff? How do you think my budgeting mind's going to work if you tell me you're just giving me dollar for dollar based on what I spend? There's no incentive for me to save, is there? So you wanted to find a way to try to create some of that incentive. And how could you do that? transportation revenue control limit changes based on the transportation support level. So that number, however, won't decrease when you decrease the transportation support level. So what happens is, let's say if it costs $5 million to transport our kids this year, and our transportation revenue control limit, just for the sake of argument, happened to be the same $5 million. And let's say next year, we put some great things into place. We've found a way to get more miles per gallon. We've done something to make our routes more effective. We don't have to travel as many miles now. And so we've greatly reduced the cost of transportation by reducing the amount of miles that we're traveling. And so that brought down the transportation support level, which is calculated based on those approved daily route miles. That brings that down to 4.8 million. Well, we still have 5 million under the transportation revenue control limit. That's a $200,000 difference. And if it's only taken us the 4.8 million to pay for the transportation, but we're going to get 5 million because we're going to get funded at the transportation revenue control limit, well, now we have $200,000 that we can spend elsewhere. And so that's the incentive for the district. So what's the incentive for the state? Because the state, of course, is always going to look out for the state. The state sets the rules. They're not going to set rules that they can't benefit from. The incentive from the state, whatever the difference is between the transportation support level and the transportation revenue control limit, will not be funded by the state. It'll be funded by the local taxpayers. So the state saves the money. The district keeps the money. The state and the district are happy. Local taxpayers, I don't know, maybe not so much. But that's the reason for why you have the two numbers. And so now we'll go into showing how you calculate those two different numbers. So the first thing, as I said, is total approved daily route miles. We're getting paid based on the miles we travel. And right now, last year, we traveled 8,826 miles a day in order to transport students to and from school. We had 6,490 students eligible to ride on those buses. So when we divide that out, that's 1.3599. That's how many miles per student. That's your total approved daily route miles divided by eligible students, get you the route miles per eligible student. Because that is above one, we get $2.37 per mile. If that was below one, we would drop down to 1.93. Pretty significant drop. So when you think of Kyrene's demographic and the students that we're transporting, you can see that if we eliminated all of our long routes and we only kept the real short routes, we could very quickly bring that per mile down to below one. In which case, we would get significantly less funding, not only because we would have significantly reduced approved daily route miles, but we would also now have to drop down to the lower rate of 1.93. And again, all these formulas are in Excel, so once you have them at your leisure, you can experiment and try a bunch of different scenarios with them. So this first step that happens is that those daily miles are now multiplied by 180 because school is in session for 180 days. And so that gives us our annual miles of just over 1.5 million. That number is then multiplied by the $2.37 that we get per mile. It gives us over $3.7 million to transport students to and from school. Now, the state realizes you don't just take kids to and from school. You know, you want to take them to the feeding zoo. You want to take them around for, you know, athletic competitions, or you want to take them around. You know, we have a superintendent student council committee that comes down. We actually bring a student out from each school. So you want to transport for other things as well. And that's why there is a trip factor. Trip factor also has two levels. You're over a mile, you get 0.12. If your students are going under a mile, and that's based on this formula over here, it's 0.10. And again, because we're over the mile, we get the 0.12. So this 3.7 million now gets multiplied by 0.12 and gives us 451,000 to help make sure we have adequate funding to cover our field trips and other little trips that we do around the district. And for students with special needs, there are sometimes situations where a student cannot take the summer off with special needs. The reason for that is regression. All students regress over the summer to different levels. That's why there's a lot of arguments for why districts should maybe have longer calendars. There's thoughts about districts being on 200-day calendars. Some districts in Arizona are adopting 200-day calendars because there is regression for students over that summer. They can't veg out and watch TV and not have some type of regression for 2 months. But in the case of special education students, if it's significant regression, it becomes a major concern. And so we have handicap extended school year mileage because some of those students have to continue to be educated over the summer so they don't have that significant regression and basically wipe out the whole year's education based on 2 months of regression. And so we get funding for that as well. And since we traveled 7,526 miles total, that's total for the summer, that's not a daily number, that's total for the summer, we get that multiplied by the $2.37, which gives us almost $18,000 for that transportation. That gives us our total transportation support level of just over $4.2 million. And that number and the outcomes down here for the calculation of the transportation revenue control limit, which is the total amount of funding we'll see for transportation. So the 4.2 million will play into calculating how much state aid we get. But the difference between this 4.2 and this 4.5 will be fully funded by local property taxes. And that's calculated by looking at where we were in the previous year. And what you'll see is that we've increased by $157,000. That's not because the district is traveling more miles. A lot of that has to do with the fact that every year the amount per mile is increased. For a long time, it was increased by 2% every year, along with our base level. That's been in place since Proposition 301 passed back in 2001, 2000. The state went, made a change, said, you know what, we reread the language that was passed, and we think we have the flexibility to choose whether or not to increase the base level by 2% or transportation per mile by 2%. And of course, they picked the transportation per mile because when you compare increasing this to increasing that $3,000 figure we talked about on the first page, this costs you significantly less. They then further redefined that and said, you know what, it's also 2% or by inflation. And inflation was 1%. So we got increased by 1% from the previous year. This year, I wouldn't be surprised if we're also only increased by 1%. But every year that number goes up. And so that's why you'll always see an increase here in the transportation support level for districts, unless they've done something to significantly reduce their amount of approved daily route miles. So that 157,000 gets added on to what our transportation revenue control limit was last year, which was just shy of 4.4 million. And that gives us our new total of $4.5 million. Now, any math whizzes in here are quickly thinking about this formula and saying, I got a great idea. Why don't you, for 1 year, not offer any transportation? In the very next year, completely restore transportation back to the same level, and now, for the rest of Kyrene's existence, you're gonna get double funding. And that sounds like a great idea. And that's why they have something in place to make sure that nobody tries that great idea. And that is that at no point in time will you get more than 120% of what the transportation support level is. So that great idea gets tossed out because in the year that you reduce your transportation support level down to zero, you will also reduce the transportation revenue control limit down to zero. And then when you restore it, you would just be coming back to the same number again. So if anyone had that idea when they were hearing all this, I just want you to know you can cast that idea out. It won't work. That is transportation revenue control limit and transportation support level. Any questions on transportation funding? Yes, Jody.
Can you explain and the 1 mile in school are slightly out of driving their kids or walking or biking or not. And they were talking about seeing if they could get a waiver. I guess you are required to provide transportation for those children, even if they use it or not. And so they were talking about seeing if they could get a waiver. And I wasn't fully understanding the pros and cons of that, but I'm just...
So the question, to repeat it for everyone else, is last year when we brainstormed all these different ideas on how we could save money for the district, what we could do more efficiently, one of the ideas that came forward was the fact that we send some buses out for these long routes and that the parents elect to drive their students in. We've already accepted the student. We've agreed, you know, that we'll take the student in, that we'll provide transportation, but the parents bringing the student in. And so the buses that are going on these long routes, in some cases, aren't full. Additionally, there are students who are waiting for transportation, in fact, not ready to choose Kyrene unless transportation is going to be provided because it's such a significant drive. The idea that came forward was, why don't we issue out waivers and have parents sign off saying, I don't intend to use the school's transportation this year, and I'll waive my right to that seat so that way you can put somebody else in it. And in theory, it's a good idea, and we tried to go forward with it. However, what we found out is that there aren't too many parents who are going to agree up front that they will never use our bus. And so we didn't get the signatures that we thought we may get. We thought some parents would come forward and sign off saying, yes, I'll never use your bus. Don't worry, but parents are more like, well, what happens if I change my mind 2 months from now? Are you going to give me that seat back? I'm like, well, no, we're already going to give it away to somebody else. I'm like, okay, yeah, I'm not comfortable with signing off on that for you then. So, yes, it was one of the ideas that came forward on how we could more efficiently fill our buses that are going on these longer routes, but it didn't exactly pan out when we tried to implement it. Yes?
Is this still funding on a how the crew fly miles for an elementary, or is it based upon the actual miles that the buses drive?
It's based on total approved daily route miles. So that's how many miles that the bus is driving. So if a bus is on a 5 mile route to bring the students in, then it's based on those 5 miles is what gets calculated for their approved daily route miles. And then again, the number of eligible students also ties into that because they have to calculate whether or not that average then comes out to more or less than 1 mile. Yes, Joey.
Another question is, if you call your district or your local school and you ask on open enrollment and will there be busing provided, you're told no. So, but I keep hearing that there is busing for open enrollment. So what truly is being provided?
We provide busing for the majority of our open enrollment. When someone is going to sign up, they're told whether or not busing will be available for their student. The state doesn't mandate that every open enrollment child must receive transportation. They leave some flexibility for a district to somewhat dictate what their open enrollment policies are. And then it's just that you apply those policies, whatever policies you set, that you apply them fairly to anyone who would then come forward and want to be a part of the district.
Yes. Who works out the math to determine the mileage, the bus is full, how often it's checked, that whole algorithm with respect to open enrollment, work where that bus is going to go, pick that child up versus, who maps all this out, puts it into the numbers? Because I can understand the basic of, okay, X number of kids qualify for bus, but then I can guarantee it only because I've seen it. Not every bus is full. And the question is, who works out the math, point A to point B to point C, and vice versa? And who looks at that on an ongoing basis to figure out whether your bus system is actually working at maximum? Because it's a necessity to why don't they one big bus cut in half and go two? Less gas, less whatever.
So essentially the question is, who is it that's setting all of our routes? Who's making the determination on what the bus routes will be and where to provide busing? We actually have a department that is dedicated to that. A couple people who work full-time on monitoring things of that nature. And throughout the course of the year, we make adjustments to routes as needed. They have some software, of course, that they use. I plug our software company, but I probably mispronounced their name, so I won't. But they have some software that they use that helps maximize and show you how to maximize the efficiency of your routing. Basically, what you do is you plug in. It has all of our student information. So all of our student information comes over into it. So the software already has all the addresses of all of our students. And it then tells you, and now I haven't played with the software, so I can't say specifically what it looks like, but it basically tells you this is a suggested route based on the addresses of your students. This is what you can do. And so the software will get you going in the right direction and give you the basis for, you know, what you want to do. The next thing you have to look at is the requests that are coming in. Because if a student is considering Kyrene, however, we haven't enrolled that student yet, then we have to look at, okay, well, where do we have students waiting to become a part of Kyrene who we've put on hold? And we've told them if we think we can provide transportation, or if we think we can do this, if we think there's room in the classrooms, we're going to take you in. Where do we have those students at? And so we have someone who works over our open enrollment numbers, looks at where those students are, and then we are somewhat selective on what students we take in through open enrollment based on our needs. For instance, not just on busing, but let's say class size. If I have some students who want to go to Lomas, and they're second grade students, but yet I look over Lomas and I see that all of their second grade classrooms are almost maxed out on the staffing level that we want to keep them at, well, then our answer to them is probably going to be no. It's going to be, you're going to have to hold off. And we'll have them hold off until there's enough of them sitting there that it would justify adding another class. Because we don't want to accept in three students and then have to hire a new teacher because now we just push this grade level over the range. And so that's actually monitored by a committee. I'm a part of the committee, but we also have many of our high-level directors and divisional leaders sit on that committee as well. Human resources, exceptional student services. We have all the directors who, during the beginning of the year, we meet basically once a week and we review all these numbers and we make those decisions. And then the initial routes that were all set out in transportation based on the transportation staff using the software and working over the numbers to see what the software helps them develop for routes that maximize efficiency.
Is that looked at on a monthly basis? I realize you just mentioned certain information is looked at on a weekly basis, but
once a route is established, we won't change an existing route because of the impact that would have on a parent who's trying to bring their kids. So I wouldn't want to call someone and say, I know you dropped little Johnny off over at the church, but we looked at it and we want to move him to the park. So we wouldn't contact all the parents and say, we've changed all of your bus stops now. So once we set the bus stops, we leave the bus stops in place. What we determine throughout the year is when we have the availability of a bus and a driver that we could possibly dedicate to another route, then we look over our numbers, and we look over our population, and we determine if we are going to use this driver and available bus for another route, where would it be most effective? And so those decisions take place during the year. And then the staffing decisions are also taking place during the year. It's really crazy over the summer, so that's why all of us don't get a summer break here, because we're working on all these things over the summer. So it's really crazy over the summer when everybody's enrolling. But then, you know, when you get into late October, November, that kind of slows down a little bit. So
what's your normal volume of change that drops, of course?
Mobility. I would say that over the course of the year, we have a significant increase after Labor Day, because in a lot of other states, school doesn't start until after Labor Day. Arizona's kind of different in that way. So people move here from out of state and they're expecting that school's gonna start after Labor Day. They come down to enroll and find out, oh, what do you mean school's been going on for a month? So we have an increase in enrollment all the way up through Labor Day. In the beginning of the year, I had mentioned before how if a student doesn't show for 10 days, we have to withdraw the student. So after that 10th day, there's a big drop off because all these students who didn't show up for the first 10 days of school, we have to take them out of our system. So you see, you start with the one number, you drop off after the 10th day enrollment, and then you have significant increases all the way up through just after Labor Day. and then it kind of just slowly increases from there. Some neighborhoods will have more move-outs than others, but district-wide, we tend to continue increasing throughout the year. So we have more coming in than we do leaving. Do we have any other questions on transportation before we move on to the next number? Next thing we're going to talk about is the revenue control limit, RCL. This number is very significant. It equals the base support level. So that number we calculated earlier when we took that total weighted student count, we multiplied it by the base level, we multiplied it by the teacher experience index, and then we added in any adjustments, such as our audit expenses, that base support level, plus transportation revenue control limit that we just talked about. There are scenarios that apply to other districts, but for the sake of simplicity, I'm only going to focus on things that apply to Kyrene. So I'm not going to talk about things like Type 03 tuition out, which would apply to some other district. I'm going to focus on the things that apply to Kyrene, and for Kyrene's revenue control limit, it is simply that base support level plus the transportation revenue control limit. So when you see those little zeros on the report and you see those other definitions next to them, don't worry, those will never apply to Kyrene, so we don't have to discuss those. And the only difference between the revenue control limit and the district support level, which are the two numbers you see there on page 2 of that A455-1, is that difference between transportation revenue control limit and transportation support level. So you'll notice that when you see those calculations on page 2, in those calculations for revenue control limit, district support level, that's the only line where you see something else has been subbed in. One of them uses transportation support level, the other uses transportation revenue control limit. The RCL is significant because the RCL is also what's used to determine overrides. And in module 2, we will go outside the RCL and we'll discuss some of those other issues like overrides and other ways that district funding is increased. So let's look at that again on our spreadsheet. Actually, I didn't make a separate tab for that one. We'll come back into that when we talk about the equalization base. But for right now, we're going to go on to some much simpler calculations. So, calculation for RCL, very complicated. It included the transportation, it included all the student weighting, it included all those other items. Transportation for capital outlay revenue limit and soft capital allocation, not so much. It's pretty straightforward. It's basically our unweighted count times an amount, and that works on both of them. Just taking that unweighted count from page 1, multiplying it by an amount. Now, if we were a high school district, we would get additional funding for textbooks, but that doesn't apply to us. So these are both just taking those unweighted ADMs, multiplying it by a number. And in the spreadsheet, I'll show you those two numbers. So capital outlay revenue limit. Capital is what you use for your purchases of buildings, buses, your big items. That's why you have capital outlay revenue limit. Now, in Kyrene, we've been fortunate enough to have a capital override in place for a number of years, which gives us some flexibility because the state allows for you to transfer some of this capital outlay revenue limit towards your maintenance and operations fund, which is the fund you use for salaries. So we've benefited from having an override in place for a long time that we didn't have to use capital for capital. We're able to push it back into salaries. We do have an override election coming up on November 8th, so we'll see if we continue to be in that same situation. But to calculate it, what you do is you take your preschool count, as you can see on the spreadsheet, that 93.625, that number that was on the top of page 1, we multiply it by $225.76. We take our K-8 count, the 16,668, and we multiply that by $225.76. Add those two numbers together, and that's our district's capital outlay revenue limit. Now, two other things that could have changed, or a couple of things that could have changed that. If we were a smaller district, less than 600 students, we could get different numbers for our capital outlay revenue limit. Again, the concept, if you can buy in bulk, you can get it cheaper. When you're buying for five kids, maybe it's a little more expensive. The max that any K district can get for capital outlay revenue limit per student is $272.75. For 9-12, it goes up to $329.41. High school districts get additional capital for textbooks. So high school districts would also get $69.68 for all of their 9-12 students. Another item that could come into play to increase capital outlay is if we had sudden growth in the district. If over the course of 1 year we grew by more than 5%, then we would get this capital outlay growth factor. So you're thinking if you're growing significantly, you gotta hurry up, you gotta go out, you gotta buy some more tables, you gotta buy some more, you know, you gotta get the desk, you gotta get the chairs, you gotta get more textbooks. And so if you're growing rapidly, they give you additional funding. We get an increase on top of our funding due to the fact that we're growing rapidly. But that's it for capital outlay revenue limit. Does anybody have any questions on the capital outlay? Yes, Tisha.
I'm understanding that's restricted capital.
No, as I stated before, the purpose of the capital funding is for capital. However, the state allows flexibility that we could take all of this capital outlay revenue, so the 3.7 million, we could shift that over into M&O. Now, after the year is done, wherever that funding was, it stays in that fund. So if we decided not to shift any of this money, we left it in capital, from that point forward, it can only be used for capital. But over the course of the year, if we wanted to shift it over to maintenance and operations, we can shift it over to maintenance and operations. Any other questions on capital? No. Now we're gonna move on to soft capital, and believe it or not, soft capital is even easier to calculate. Every one of those unweighted students multiplied by 225, nice and even. No other rules to worry about, just it's multiplied by 225. So that gets sold together, and you'll see for capital outlay revenue limit, we're getting just shy of 3.8 million. And not much difference in soft capital. Now, anyone that, like me, and you like to follow what's going on at the state, you'll know that the state has made cuts to unrestricted capital, the capital outlay revenue limit that's shown up there, and also the soft capital. But yet, you don't see those cuts here. You don't see those cuts on those reports, those A455-1s that are handed out to you. You will see those cuts when we go through Module 2. Now I'll show you how this $3.7 million was cut by basically 97.5%, and how this capital outlay revenue was basically cut in half. And so when we go through Module 2, I'll show you how the legislative cuts reduce those numbers. So now we've gotten there. Basically, coming on to the tail end of the presentation, we're going to be going home to watch the Diamondbacks soon, don't worry. We've gotten to the equalization base. The equalization base is now taking these numbers that we've just discussed and totaling them. And you'll see that on page 4 of your report. On page 4, that A455-1, you'll see the equalization base. You'll see how it adds in that district support level, the capital outlay revenue limit, the soft capital, and it gives you a total. That's the equalization base. That's how much money that the district is gonna get. So what do you need to figure out next? Okay, that's great. Who's giving us the money? And so to determine that, we have to talk about equalization assistance. Equalization assistance is taking that base, subtracting out what's called a qualifying levy, and then what's left is what the state will give you. So basically, you're entitled to X number of dollars. we feel that based on your assessed valuations, you should be able to raise this portion from your tax base. What's left, we'll give you. So if our entitlement of dollars goes down, guess who's saving the money? The state, right? Because they're still gonna say we should be able to raise X number of dollars from our tax base. It's just that the entitlement went down, which means how much they're kicking out over the top ends up going down. So that's why when we talk about things that would cut funding, we have to remember that when we cut the funding for doing changes in transportation, for losing some of our enrollment, that's not gonna save our local taxpayers, that's gonna save the state. So let's talk about how that plays out by looking at the calculation of the qualifying levy on our spreadsheet, which is also on page 4 of your 8455-1. So again, on the top, you can see that all these different items are totaled together to get our equalization base. It's the base support level plus a transportation support level that gives you a district support level that gets added to capital outlay and soft capital. And our equalization base is $87.2 million. The determination for how much of that needs to come from local property taxes and how much will come from the state is based on two variables. First variable, what is the assessed valuation of the district? How much is the district worth? Take the assessed valuation of each home, business, SRP, total them all up, that primary assessed valuation, what's the total evaluation for the district? Divide that by 100 and then multiply it by the qualifying tax rate. So where do we get the qualifying tax rate? The state knows how much money they want to spend on education statewide. And they know that if you just had one qualifying tax rate and you set that to the end of time, and then all of a sudden you started increasing that per pupil number, since they're funding every dollar that you get over meeting this qualifying levy, their obligations and liabilities would continue to climb. So what they do is they reset this qualifying tax rate each year based on looking at assessed valuations over the entire state, knowing how much money they want to spend. So they say, we want to spend $3 billion. Steve's the guy down at Joint Legislative Budget Committee who has the fun of coming up with this qualifying tax rate. Steve, tell us what's the magic number? What do we need to set the qualifying tax rate to make sure we only spend X number of dollars on education this year? They're not concerned how much is going to come from local property taxes. Tell us what we need to do to make this rate give us back the level that we want to spend on education from state funding. Comes up with the magic number. This year the magic number was 1.8682. So based on that, they know from looking at everyone's assessed valuations what their liability is going to be. And so that 1.8682 is multiplied against that assessed valuation after the assessed valuation was divided by 100 and comes up with a qualifying levy. Qualifying levy for us, $46.2 million. So they're saying, raise $46.2 million from local property taxes before you ask us for any additional funding on top of that. And so the equalization assistance then is $40 million because it's the 87.2 minus the 46. The 46.2 gets you $40.9 million. Sorry, I said 87 minus 46 was 40. It just didn't sound right to me, so I had to make sure I looked at the numbers. It's good because we got that 989,000 after that 40, so that's good. So that gives you the 40, almost $41 million right there. And that's how much we get for equalization assistance. So that's what's being sent down to us in state aid. Now, one other note on the qualifying tax rate. Qualifying tax rate is a universal rate set for all districts. So they look at what everybody needs to be and they say, this is the qualifying tax rate. With one exception, if you are a career ladder or OPIB district, you get a higher qualifying tax rate because they want to ensure that your local property taxes are helping to pay for that system. When it was originally established, it was 2 cents for every percent. So at our peak, when we were getting 5.5%, we had 11 cents added onto our qualifying tax rate. When they came up with the idea for the phase out, not only did they want to make sure that they phased out career ladder and make it go away, they wanted to, as quickly as possible, take every state dollar away from career ladder. So when they dropped from 5 to 4%, they said, we're not doing 2 cents for every percent anymore. When you're at 5%, you had to throw 10 cents on your qualifying tax rate. When you're at 4%, you're going to throw 10 cents on your qualifying tax rate. When you get down to 3%, 2%, you're going to continue to throw 10 cents on your qualifying tax rate, and that program will be fully funded by local property taxes in no time. Ours is almost fully funded by local property taxes now. So we have a qualifying tax rate that is 10 cents higher than most districts because we have a career ladder program. So that is the calculation for equalization assistance. And that is the end of module one. So I know it's been a long night. Does anybody have any questions on any of the material covered here tonight? Next year is 3, year after that is 2, year after that is 1, year after that is 0, we're done. So it's about 3 more years from now, yeah. We're at 4 right now.
So once career ladder phases out, we go back to the same standard statewide rate?
On the qualifying tax rate portion, yes. We'll be in the same qualifying tax rate as everyone else at that point. Hopefully sooner, I'm sure we'll have the right people talking to them about how we need to bring that a little more fairly in line in the near future.
I know you haven't talked about the cost side of all this yet, but on your cost side estimates, your teacher cost estimates, have you factored in kind of a supply-demand factor to the idea that probably as this career ladder starts to drop, fewer teachers will do it and take advantage of it?
That'll be, well, one other thing with the career ladder is that if you weren't participating in career ladder basically about 3 years ago, the first thing they did is said, no more new teachers can join Career Ladder. And that all happened as part of the Gilbert lawsuit. Gilbert was actually the district that came forward and said, we're upset, we can't be Career Ladder, this isn't fair. So they started the lawsuit, and one of the first actions that was taken by the state was, don't put any more teachers in Career Ladder because we don't want to have to deal with taking this funding away from teachers and the fallout from that. So they said, the amount of teachers we have it in already is enough to deal with, so we're not going to allow any new teachers into the program. But as far as doing studies such as what happens to teachers now as this funding goes away and us staying competitive with other districts as far as our salaries, that type of analysis is going on now. In fact, it might be one of our topics of discussion during the Citizens Budget Council. Any other questions? No? All right, well, thank you all for coming. And go D-backs. Go watch them win tonight. So that way some of you can get to the game tomorrow. I'll be watching it on TV tomorrow as well as tonight. If you didn't get a chance to sign in earlier, please make sure you sign in. I'm going to send you all your goodies through email. At the conclusion of Module 2, you're going to get more than enough things that you could possibly think of. Information on finding out not only everything about our finances, but the finances of any charter or district in the state. But I can't get that to you if I don't have a good email address, so make sure you sign in. And also, for anyone who's part of the Citizens Budget Council, it is a requirement that you've attended the 2 modules in person in order to be a part of the Citizens Budget Council. So make sure you sign in. Don't count on my memory, remembering exactly everybody that was here. Thank you.